Good morning, everybody. Hope everybody can hear me. My name is Mark Woodward. Thank you for taking time out of your busy day to join us today. We're going to do some safety basics for every company. And I want to say good morning to everybody again. And I'm going to share my screen. I got a lot going on today. Want to wave at you guys. And once again, say thank you. I'm going to just let everybody know, I'm going to share a couple of websites for everybody listening in today. I've got some printed documents that we'll refer to and a PowerPoint. And I'm going to do a couple of things here this morning really quickly. I want to send my contact info to everyone. My name is Mark Woodward, and I'm in safety training here at Missouri Employers Mutual. And my contact info is mwoodwar@mem-ins.com. And my cell phone number, if you'd like to just give me a call one of these days, just to chat about this presentation, or if you need anything, any safety consultation, resources, materials, give me a call. I can help you out. Also, after the presentation today, I'm going to be sending out resources to everybody that logged in today. I'll send my PowerPoint and that kind of thing. And then just please keep in touch with me because I'd like to help you out. Don't think that this is a one and done presentation and you can't call. That's what we're here for. That's what I'm here for. Recognize a lot of names on the call today. Greatly appreciate everything that you're doing. Greatly appreciate you hopping on for the presentation today. And we've got the chat thing going here today too. And the presentation is safety must-haves for any business. And I really need everybody on the call today to get a pen and a notepad because I'm going to need you to do some research work on your own end, on your own company. Okay, safety must-haves. These are things that we really need you to do. We want you to do and be successful at with regard to safety program management, safety system management, whatever you want to call it. These are safety must-haves. They are proven best practices to help you reduce the frequency of injuries that come across your desk, which means how many, and then also the severity, which means how bad they were. We need to do two things with your organization. We need to prevent people from getting hurt because that's the moral and ethical thing to do, correct? Second thing we need to do is make your company more financially successful, because injuries have a cost, and we will talk about those. And if you have questions through this, don't hesitate. I'm going to actually share a different screen really quickly, because I think when I share the screen the way I did a minute ago, you couldn't really see the entire PowerPoint. So now you should be able to see the entire PowerPoint. And I recognize some folks on the call today, and I know that they have really great safety programs like John Fields with Oates Transport. There's a lot of good folks on the line today on this call. And I'm going to ask you to type these in. Type in an answer. Type in an answer if you would. And I'm going to ask you what you think a safety must have would be for any company. What would be a safety must have for any size or type of business? And I say business, I mean operation. It could be municipality. Does anybody want to type it in? What's something you do? Do you do you have a written safety rules? What is it? What do you do? What do you do? Anybody want to type something in? What's something that you feel you really do great at when it comes to your safety plan or your safety program? Does anybody want to type something in? Debbie says safety policies in place. Great, Debbie. That is great. Now, with safety policies, the challenge and one of the things I want you to do is write down, when was the last time you reviewed these safety policies with every employee? Okay. When was the last time they were updated? Okay, the more we put the safety policies out there for employees, the better off they're going to be. I also encourage you to stay away from the annual safety policy sign-off. We need to do that more often, because remember that the safety plan, the safety system that we're talking about, must reduce injuries. What else? Do you guys do? What else do you do to help reduce injuries in your particular operation? Somebody want to type something in? What do you want to type in? So we're going to talk about these things: training, inspections, okay, developing safety policy. I'm going to show some photos. We'll chat about these things. I do have a lot of content here, so I will email this out. Okay, one of the things I want to mention is thank you for jumping on here today. Thank you for your attention to safety. We want to just remind folks that safety is never done. Safety never takes a break. We only improve our safety processes, our safety plans. Okay. And then once again, if you have any questions over anything that we've talked about today, please give me a call or send me an email. And my thought process with safety is we have to continually message our employees for zero injuries. We have what the company can do to make folks safer, and then what we have, what the employee can do themselves to make their work and their work safer. Safety, as a lot of you know, is not just discussing things that occur at work. We're constantly talking about people's health. We're talking about people's safety at home as well. So there's really a lot of work we need to do to really create that culture of safety in your company. So we just want to challenge you, zero injuries in 2021. And I put 2021, I want zero injuries for the rest of 2020, but let's make a plan in your operation. Everybody that's on the line today, on our WebEx today, let's make a plan. What do we need to do to have zero injuries in your operation in 2021? So let's think about that. If you want to chat about that stuff, call me, send me an email. So some things that we think about is why injuries occur and why are costs so high? So I want to think about that. I want you guys to think about that. Minimal or no safety activities occurring, no or minimal injury management occurring. So what do you do? Are you doing, do you have safety policies, safety rules, whatever you want to call them, a safety plan? Are we doing safety meetings? I would hope so. Are we enforcing existing safety rules? Meaning we have a seatbelt policy, but nobody's bothering to enforce it. The employees just do whatever they want. Is anybody correcting any unsafe machines, conditions, problems with the building? And then when an injury occurs, the reason why the costs go crazy is we don't really have a plan. So I really need you to look at what you're really doing. And I don't want you to just tell me. I don't want you to just tell me things. I need you to really look at what you're actually doing. What is actually going on in your operation? Actually going on in your operation. And then same with the injury management plan. And we'll keep moving. Some things to think about are the amount, is the sheer quantity of money we're talking about. I need you to find something out. How much do you currently pay in work comp? How much have you paid in fines? If you have company drivers, have they been getting traffic tickets? Are your trucks being pulled over? What are you paying for all of this? I know that whenever the phone rings and a claim comes into MEM, the average of all the claims that we get a year, every single time the phone rings, it's $15,000 somebody's spending. I know that the average lost workday claim is $60,000. 60 grand is the average for a lost workday claim. For somebody to die on the job, to be killed, is 1.3 million. And then the largest work comp claim MEM currently has that we're working is $11 million. And that is a serious quadriplegia injury where we will be paying significant amounts. This person needs a lot of care. So that's medical. So the money's there, and it's just, I just review these numbers with you as well. What would actually happen in your operation if you had one of these incidents occur? So what we really have to do is look at safety, and the safety processes that we recommend are not difficult. Remember that. They are not difficult at all. They're for every size of business. Now, I have quite a list here. I have quite a list here. Safety must-haves. Let's start with number one, management must commit. A lot of folks on the phone here today, does the top management in your operation really understand what they're paying for, what they're paying in workers' compensation, what they're paying in fines? Are they happy with that, or do they want their costs to go down? And what do they want to do in terms of efficiency and keeping people at work and protecting people? Management must commit. We have a very difficult time making safety inroads when we're dealing with customers that just really don't have management that wants to commit. You may have a customer contact that we work with, but their bosses don't commit. So let's analyze that and figure out a strategy that we can do, some strategies that we can do to get more management commitment. First of all, let's start with costs and explain to them, what are you really paying? Understanding costs, safety rules. Okay, and number two, understanding costs. What is your current experience modifier rate? So write that down. If you don't know what it is, remember we talked about that in the last session. What is your current EMOD rate? What are you currently paying for premium? I work with a lot of folks that have no idea what they're currently paying. And we talk about that. It's a lot of money. What is going on with regard to claims? Have you had any claims? Are you familiar with what is going on right now with any claims that you currently have? Safety rules, that's a must have. Now remember, I said safety rules. I didn't say safety plan, safety program. I didn't say that you and your company need to go out and develop a big monster binder. Didn't say that. We need written safety rules that are communicated, developed, communicated, and enforced. I didn't say need to do this. And in fact, I didn't say anything about OSHA, did I? We love OSHA. We work with, we work with those folks and understand them. But I didn't say that. I said safety rules. We will go back to that. Regular safety meetings. When are you doing safety meetings? I get a lot of calls from folks that say, Mark, I need you to come in and do our annual safety meeting. In my opinion, it's not effective. We need to get our employees together on a regular basis. On a regular basis to discuss our safety rules, seasonal changes in the operation, or hazards that have popped up. And we need to do that on a regular basis. Okay. Not once a year. Once a year is like convenient for management, but it's not effective from a safety standpoint. Corrective action documentation. When an infraction is discovered or an unsafe behavior is discovered, what happens? When an unsafe machine or tool is discovered, what happens? And do we even document any of this? It's in your best interest to document, so we'll talk about that. Inspect job sites, tools, buildings, and vehicles. We are not inspecting enough of our equipment and buildings. We should be finding hazards before they find our employees. When we get those hazards corrected, then document it. Show what you're doing. Drug-free workplaces. Every employer on the phone today should have a drug-free workplace policy. We'll chat about that. Every employer on the phone should have a written seatbelt policy. Every employer on the phone, on our call, I say on the phone, I probably shouldn't stay on the phone. On our webinar today, drives for the benefit of the company. If that's true, we need to be wearing our seatbelts. Distracted driving, distracted work policy. Cell phones are causing injuries and deaths across the United States. We need to address that. New hires, attention and expectations, post-offer employment physicals. That's the list. And I think in that list, I think everything in this list is doable for any business. There's a lot here. But remember, what's the opposite end of the spectrum here where we have a really bad injury and it puts serious financial strain on our operation? So we're going to talk about how we can manage all this. Look at the slip, fall on ice. Look at the ice. This is an inspection point. We should have known that was there, and we should have done something about it because that ice patch cost us $60,000. The broken ladder, the junk ladders. Did you know? Write this down. This is interesting too. Ladders are the single most dangerous piece of equipment your employees will ever use, including yourself at your own home, cleaning out gutters and hanging Christmas lights. Ladders cause immense pain and suffering and death. And people fall, ladders tip over, and we don't follow ladder safety rules. Cluttered workspaces that result in strained sprains, slip falls, okay? Vehicle crashes. In Missouri, we have around 950 fatalities on our highways every year. Right now, it's running about 70% of those folks are not wearing a seatbelt. If you have a fleet, please, please develop a written seatbelt policy. I can send you one. Just email me. I'll send it to you. And all you have to do is overlay it with your business card and start enforcing it. Then we have tool injuries, hand injuries, foot injuries, the traumatic injuries. Number one in terms of employee injuries in the hierarchy is going to be slip fall, followed by number two, strain, sprain, orthopedic injury, overexertion injury. The third most common type of injury that we deal with is a vehicle crash, motor vehicle crash. Fourth is what we would call caught in or struck by hazardous contact. And that's basically a tool or a machine, you know, nail gun, shoot yourself with a nail gun, that kind of thing. These are very, very expensive. And they're very painful for your employee because a lot of them require multiple surgeries. This is one particular story that's sad. And I need everybody to understand this. When we talk about safety basics that all employers can do, I want you to think about this. When we talk about safety plan, safety system, safety program, whatever you want to call it, your safety rules, your document of your safety expectations, I'm not talking about this. I'm not talking about the three-ring binder. I don't expect you to develop a three-ring binder. Okay? You got to think about this. How many injuries would have been prevented if employees would have followed one rule? So on your to-do list, go back and look at the employee injuries, the claims that you have sent in either to MEM or a past carrier. Go back and look at your past losses and say, what one rule would have made the difference? This particular truck was a feed truck, farming operation type deal, and the employee could not get there's an auger there at the bottom of the truck, and that auger runs through the tank, and the employee couldn't get the auger to start, so he jumps in the tank with a broom handle and jams the broom handle down in the auger helix. The auger starts, and unfortunately, he suffered a leg amputation. This is a $3 million injury. $3 million. He's 24 years old. And I ask folks, what does a 24-year-old know about this equipment? Secondly, what does the safety rule say on the equipment? The safety rule said that on the owner's manual said that if the auger doesn't start, simply take a rubber mallet and whack the tube that the auger's in, and that will jostle the feed, and the auger will start. One safety rule would have saved $3 million. So I need you to really look at that. What are the core critical safety rules in your operation? Do you have folks working from heights? Do they need fall protection, ladder safety? Do you have people driving? Do you have people lifting things, moving things, driving forklifts? What are the core critical operations that we need safety rules on? Also, this is an example of a low-speed truck incident where the truck rolled off the right side of the road, flipped over on its roof, but the employee fell from the seat, broke his neck, $9 million loss to that company. Not to mention the truck and the trailer and the damage to the property and goods and everything else. And the employee was not wearing a seatbelt, fell out of the seat, broke his neck, and is now quadriplegic. $9 million in losses. A seatbelt. One safety rule. So I'm begging you, go out and look at past incidents that have happened. Okay? And take a look at that. Ask yourself about safety rules. So with safety, the starting point is management, but I want to be fair to management and say, do they really know? What are they really paying for? Have they really seen any information from you with regard to, this is our work comp premium. Do you realize it's this high? This is our EMOD rate. These are the rate tiers we're in. Work with your agent and MEM or your carrier to figure out what are you paying? A lot of companies, unfortunately, don't really know what they're paying. They've never sat down and looked at it. Also, I put show me safety. Employees see activity. They see behavior. They see what management is doing. Okay, they know if management's not enforcing rules. They know if management's being cheap and doesn't want to make safety improvements. They know this. And it'll come out. What is your company value? Is management involved? Are rules communicated and enforced? The biggest thing with safety rules is the enforcement. Bob's been with the company for years. Bob's a good employee. We don't need to do that to Bob. Or safety improvements. It'll be all right. It'll be all right. I just need you to really think about what can we do to get management support. And if you need our backup to help you do that, we can help with that. Moving ahead, knowing money, and I'm not going to spend a whole lot of time on this, but what's your mod rate? How much are you paying? What's your minimum mod? If you really went loss free and you had the zero injury 2021, what would it help do? How would it improve your mod and your costs? So ask your agent, ask MEM, what could my minimum mod be and how much money are we talking about? This is right now a $32,000 account with a 1.1 mod. The average is 1.0 mod. Their minimum mod could be, if they went loss free, 0.74, which means they're leaving $10,000 on the table. What could folks on our WebEx today do with an extra 10 grand in their operation? So think about that. Know your mod, get with your agent, get with us, we'll tell you and we'll explain it. The E-mod rate means anything over one, like in this picture here, the 1.2. The 0.2 means you're paying 20% more than suggested retail price. But that's really not the case. The minimum mod in this case is 0.8. There's a 40% variance there, which means you're technically paying 40% more for work comp. And that's excluding all the extra fees that we put on you because you're over a one. So things to think about, right? And then also that claims last an awful long time. You have a claim today, it's not going away till 2025. It's going to be on your records till 2025. We'll talk about this. And that's, by the way, that's weird to say that, 2025. But that's the way it is. And then another thing I need you to add to your to-do list is calculate the direct and indirect cost of these claims. If you have any direct cost that you have, tow bills, repair bills, everything else, also work comp, calculate it out. For every dollar that you spent in a bill, black and white, direct cost, I want you to calculate out what the indirect cost was. Multiply that number times 4. If you had a $100,000 loss, then you're looking at $400,000 in additional soft costs, indirect costs. They're very expensive. So safety, we have to do what we can to reduce your risk. How are they hurt? Like we said, slip, trip, fall, strain, injured by, struck by, or injured by, and then motor vehicle. Those are your 4. Now, the reason why I'm mentioning this is this will hopefully help give you focus. This is across all industries. You are more likely to have a slip, trip, fall, a slip, trip, or fall, an injury related to a slip, an injury related to a trip, or a slip with a fall, or a trip with a fall, or a fall from heights. You're more likely to have a strain or injured by, or an overexertion injury. You're more likely to have a struck or injured by, a hand tool type of injury, and a vehicle crash. This should be focus. When we do safety meetings, we need to focus on this. So number 1, management commitment. Number 2, understand cost. Number 3, focus on how people are being hurt. Go back and look at your safety meetings. Are we talking about these things? Are we providing PPE that address these issues? Who is getting hurt? The state Workers' Compensation Division of Work Comp says that the most commonly injured age group are males from 41 to 49 years of age. You may want to write that down, males 41 to 49 years of age. But new hires are overrepresented in injury statistics. 36% of claims coming to MEM are new hire injuries, employed for less than a year. But don't forget that new hires doesn't mean new, young workers. Young workers are actually, they're hardly ever represented in work comp statistics. If you look at 18 to like 28-year-olds, 18 to 29-year-olds, they hardly have any injuries compared to the 41 to 49s because they don't know the tricks. They don't know the bad habits. So I'm going to focus also on new hires. So you want to write that down as a safety basic. Anybody that's new that's working for you, review your safety plan, spend some extra time with them. But remember that new hire doesn't mean young worker. It could be any age group, okay? Moving ahead, work-related fatalities. We've talked about this in the past. Folks that have been to MEM seminars before know that we fuss about vehicle crashes day in and day out because they're such a big problem. The number one cause of fatality for employees at work through the day is vehicle crash, followed by falls. We do have some struck bys. We have miscellaneous. Miscellaneous is kind of an odd one. That's your heart attacks and things. Those are your heart attacks and folks that have strokes, that kind of thing at work that we're not really sure if it's work-related or not, but we take an injury report anyway. Biggest thing about motor vehicle crash is distracted driving policies, seatbelt policies. I have those. You can send me an email. I'll send them to you. Falls, we tie off ladders or use a fall protection gear like fall arrest harnesses. That's it. Your problems go away. But if they're not wearing fall arrest harnesses, if they're not using ladder safety practices or boom lifts, then they are at an increased risk. So moving ahead, also, when we talk about OSHA, a trick that I use for any company that I do a little bit of safety consulting with, when we're worried about OSHA citations, and then what I look at is what they call the top 10 violations. OSHA has a statistics page where they actually tell you what they've been doing in each state and the most frequently cited standards in each SIC code or in each industry. So you can go and find your industry and look and see what OSHA's been citing. Then at that point, we look at how we can address what OSHA wants. So now we start to look at a couple things. If you're worried about OSHA, then I go to the top 10 violations list. Fall protection and construction. Well, that's easy. If they're not tied off, you get a citation. If they're using ladders wrong, they get a citation. Hazard communication standard in general industry. If you don't have safety data sheets, chemical list, employee training as to what that all means, then that's a violation. Scaffolding and construction, improper scaffolding setup, lockout, tagout. If you're working on a machine and it will kick on or fall on somebody when you're doing maintenance, then it's a violation. If you don't have a lock in there. Respiratory protection, ladders and construction, forklifts. How many of your operators on forklifts haven't been trained? Okay. Brenda, I will send you those policies, okay? Forklift operators, fall protection, training, and construction. You can't just put somebody in a harness. Machine guarding, if you've got exposed gears and chains and things there. To include table saw blades, that's a violation. So you can find all this. So now, we have two things we think about, two strategies. Preventing injuries, slip, trip, fall, strain, sprain, vehicle crash, etc. And then going after what OSHA's really going to see. But also remember, I'm not talking about just complying with OSHA. I'm talking about these are how people get hurt. And this is how OSHA gets called into your operation. Okay? So I hope this is helping. Moving ahead, we look at two things as well. Frequency, and we mentioned this earlier, frequency and severity. How many were there? How bad were they? And we also talk about that. The reason why we need safety is because we want to get the quantity of injuries down in your operation. Or if you haven't had any claims, if you haven't had any injuries and you just haven't had any for a while, how do we keep it that way? So how many do we have, but then how bad were they? OSHA has mandatory reporting. You have to call OSHA if somebody dies on the job. You have to call them within 8 hours. If you don't, they're going to cite you on it. They're going to fine you for it. The reason why we want you to really focus on safety is because if you have an eye injury, a loss of an eye, an amputation, or an inpatient hospitalization incident, you know, that's going to hit work comp, but it's also, OSHA also requires you to call that in within 24 hours. So you will get a visit by OSHA if you do that, by the way. They're going to come investigate it. So you not only have to deal with work comp, you have to deal with OSHA citations. So frequency is how many injuries you had, but we need to get the severity of the injury down by safety, okay? So the difference between injury prevention and compliance, we know OSHA, we do OSHA, we understand all about OSHA, but the MEM, the difference between us and OSHA, we know all the standards, but we use any means necessary to prevent injuries. The task is to prevent injuries. We will save money after that. Did you know that OSHA really doesn't have anything to say about drug-free workplaces? OSHA does not require a seatbelt policy. OSHA does not require a distracted driving policy. Oh, they reference it and talk about it here and there, but they don't require this stuff. Did you know that OSHA does not investigate highway incidents that kill employees? So there's things they do, there's things we do. What I encourage you to do is don't just focus on OSHA compliance for safety of your employees. Let's look at all best practices. And we know that with OSHA, the citations are very expensive now. Missouri has made a name for itself as the second most expensive OSHA citation in OSHA's history came out of Missouri a couple of years ago. It was $720,000. But remember that these fines can be very expensive. Your serious, up to willful violation fines can be $134,000 per violation. What they mean by per violation is per employee. So just keep that in mind. And also to think about, say, another way of thinking about safety is, let's not look at it by buying equipment as just we're buying equipment. Let's look at it as what can we save? What can we avoid? How can we be more efficient? This company bought a trench box through MEM Safety Grant Program. They had it about a month, and then a chunk of soil came off the wall of this trench and fell against the trench box. It's estimated to weigh about 600 pounds, and we estimated the injuries on the employee to be $60,000, but they didn't happen. We had the trench box in place. It didn't happen. That protected the employee from cave-in, trench cave-in. We avoided a $60,000 claim. When we look at everything, the value of avoiding the loss and everything else, the total return on investment was $238,000. And we coughed up $8,000 to help them buy the box in the safety grant program. So think about that. You may look on your to-do list, write down, what return on investment am I going to get for all of these safety improvements that we make? So don't just look at it as an outlay. Go ahead and calculate out what we can get on return on investment from an efficiency standpoint, cash savings, that kind of thing. So let's keep moving. So when we look at your previous losses, they're going to help direct us as to what the safety improvements are we're going to make, safety must-haves we're going to put in place. Look at your past losses, your past fines, that kind of thing. Why'd they happen in the first place? What was wrong? And then secondly, why were the costs not contained? Why did it cost so much? Why'd they happen in the first place? What was missing? And then why did it cost so much? Another thing to think about as well is your safety activities, management commitment, safety rules, which we will talk about, safety meetings, okay, knowing your cost, all these things. We need to really look at pictures like this, and you see all these photos all over the internet, employees breaking safety rules. This is an interesting picture because I really want you to do something for me. I want you to chat in. Everybody has the chat function here, and I'm going to type in hello, and I'm going to ask a very simple question. Why? So if you asked this employee, why are you on the top rung of that ladder? What's the reason? Why are you there? Because under his feet, it says not a step. I think everybody on the WebEx today knows it's not a step. You know, it shouldn't be there. What reasons would the employee give us? Type that in. Trying to get the job done. I haven't had any training. So right there, you're saying common sense is out the window. We should not be saying common sense and safety. So I'm trying to get the job done. What else? Somebody else typed something in. Cheryl, she typed in, the employee would say, I'm trying to get the job done. What else? Somebody else say something. Chat those answers in. Quicker to stay on the top than go get a new ladder. Thank you, Brenda. You're exactly right. What about I'm in a hurry? Hurry? Right? Tired? fatigued, nothing will happen to me. That is complacency. Now, what I'm going to really try to blow everybody's mind here. My question is, do safety signs and do safety warnings work? Now, think proper ladder is not available. Now, that could be true. So that's an organizational issue, right? So what I want you to really think about here is the human element. The human element, why people do what they do. Now, if you had all the proper safety gear, all the safety equipment, everything you needed, everything was perfect, we all sat around and made $1 million doing our work, everything was fine, would people still break safety rules? And I think the answer is yes. Why would somebody not wear a hard hat if they have a hard hat? Well, there's a ton of reasons, but they're in a hurry, they're trying to get something done, they're complacent, they don't even think they need it. What we have to address is the human element, okay? And the safety rules and things like that you need to level with people. Okay. And will this activity cause an accident? I want you to think about that. Will the activity cause an accident? The answer is no. Not an accident. It's called Tuesday at Missouri Employers Mutual. Gee, an employee was standing on the top rim of a ladder and fell and cost $60,000. That happens 30 times a day at MEM. So people need to understand that they may be trying to get the work done, but they're going to cause massive destruction financially into their own bodies if they continue to do this. Also, I want you to understand something very interesting. What is very interesting about the words under his feet, not a step? What is very important about the words under his feet? What's very important about that? He broke that safety rule. What do I need to know about that? What is interesting about, what does everybody on the call need to know about Missouri Work Comp as it relates to safety rules? Who knows? There's a specific thing, and folks that have been through our seminars know this, have heard this before. In Missouri, Work Comp, the state statute supports safety rules. Okay? Does anybody want to type that in? You can unmute as well. Anybody want to give it a shot? When safety rules are not followed and an injury results, up to a 50% penalty can be applied to work comp benefits. When we talk safety rules here in a few minutes, it's very important that you understand the work comp penalty, the safety penalty. If you don't follow safety rules in the state of Missouri, and the employer is doing their best to communicate and enforce these safety rules, there could be a penalty. What that employee is doing right now is not only putting their life in danger, they're putting the business in danger, they're putting their work comp benefits to their family and their income in danger. We will chat about that. So we'll keep moving. All right, let's talk about this. Let's go for it. Offensive safety measures, what you are currently physically doing in the safety plan, the offense, what are we doing to go after incidents and injuries? And then what are we doing to control the costs? Now, Steve Summers will talk about lost costs on our next call next month. You really need to hear this presentation. It's injury management plans. What I need you to do is look at, split your safety plan in half. Maybe I oversimplify safety plans, whatever you want to call it, safety system, safety rules, whatever you do, safety program, split it in half. I want you to make a list of what you're actually doing before the incident to prevent the incident. An example of that is, we know winter's coming. What are we doing now to prevent wintertime type of injuries, slips, falls, and vehicle crashes? What are you doing before the incident to prevent the incident? Safety meetings, safety rules, safety enforcement. And then number two, which I'm not really going to talk about, we'll talk about that next month, would be the injury management plan. So number one is preventing the incident. What are we doing to prevent the incident? Number two is, what are we doing? To keep the costs low and get our employee back to work as soon as possible? Cheryl Graber emailed or just sent a just sent me a note saying, is the message on top of the ladder considered a safety rule? The answer is absolutely, Cheryl. But we would want somewhere back at your office a safety rule and a safety plan of some sort where we talk to our employees about ladder safety and they sign it. And we will talk about that. It is a safety rule. Let's keep moving. Going on the offense. When was the last time policies were acknowledged? If you're only doing it on an annual basis, I don't recommend that at all. We have to be effective. So we need to be acknowledging safety policies on a regular basis. When was the last time your employees saw the safety plan? You need to ask yourself that. Your employees, when was the last time they saw the safety plan and you read down through it? Have you reached every employee with a safety message, even your part-time or night staff? Have you addressed unsafe acts or conditions? I know in the back of your mind, you know of something out there that could be fixed or improved. Okay, and we need to get those done. Have you enforced safety rules lately? We have a safety plan. We have the safety rules, right? I'm going to get an example here. We have safety rules, but these safety rules are worthless unless somebody stops those unsafe acts and behaviors and corrects them. Have job sites, buildings, and equipment been inspected? Are new hires addressed? Are employees responsible for infractions? Held responsible. But are they rewarded for good scores? Have we ever told an employee thank you for working safely? And employees, are employees fit for duty? And I'm going to send this PowerPoint to everybody when we're done. Post-offer employment testing is something that we're really pushing, recommending. Understanding costs, premium, claims. This is before the incident. To prevent the incident, we need to understand our costs. We need to get management commitment, written safety rules that are regularly communicated through safety meetings. Corrective action and documentation. If you fixed an issue, document that. But if you confronted an employee about an unsafe situation, okay, document that. Inspect job sites, tools, buildings, and vehicles for unsafe things like bad tires, bad ladders. Drug-free workplaces. That's another thing that most companies talk about annually during their HR stuff. I don't believe we need to do that. I think we need to do quarterly. I think we need to do that on a regular basis. This is a drug-free workplace. We believe in it very strongly. And this is what's going to happen, you know, if you have drugs in your system after an incident. Written seatbelt policy, distracted driving policy, taking more time with new hires and post-offer employment physicals. Now, let's get down to some, and I have more content here than I think we can get through today. I'm starting to realize I'm awfully wordy. This isn't your safety plan. That book right there, if you have a safety plan that you haven't looked at lately, we've got a problem. MEM does not recommend you do this. Now, if you have to, you have to. If you need to be compliant with OSHA and do this, then go right ahead. What we require is for you to tackle losses, tackle injuries with written safety rules. Now, you can have this book. Not saying you don't need this book. You might need this. A compliance manual. If you've got a lot going on, you may need this. FRA, DOT type stuff, I get it. But what I want you to do is go after injuries. I want you to develop one page of safety rules. What do you have to do to work in your operation and be safe? Have we ever thought about that? One page of safety rules. How easy would it be for you to hand out your safety rules if it was one page? I'm talking the big ticket stuff. The big ticket stuff. Company safety rules. Company safety rules. Now, your departmental safety rules. Let's say you have two or three departments. Assembly department, welding department, construction department, that kind of thing. Now you start to develop bigger things, more safety content. And then the machine specific, like lock cap, tag out, individual training on machines, you may develop that safety system, that safety program. But the big ticket items, like what is causing people to be hurt, seat belts, distracted driving, distracted work, this is a drug-free workplace, get it on one sheet of paper. Now you can have your big manual, but put in the very front of the book your safety rules. Now, imagine how much easier life would be if you had one sheet of safety rules and you had employees sign one sheet of safety rules every time you did a safety meeting. Also, does anybody want to type this in? Please type this in. What's the average reading grade level for the adult Missouri? So Cheryl said eighth grade. It's like sixth grade. So Cheryl, what would happen if I gave an employee this? What would happen if I gave an employee that reads at a sixth grade level this? They're not going to read it. They're not going to understand it. I'm not faulting them. It just is what it is. I have to get effective. And also, is it fair to the employee? What's it always? You guys on the WebEx today, what's the last page of every big safety book or the last page of your personnel manual say? What's the very last page say? And during new hire orientation, we always give the employee a pen. And what do we make them do? What's the last page of this manual say, the safety manual say? I know somebody out there knows what the last page of the safety manual always says, or the personnel manual. Michael says they sign it, that they've read it. And is that true? Answer is no, they haven't read this. It'll go in the floorboard of their Camaro, but they'll never read it. It's ineffective. But now if I had one sheet of paper that says, wear your personal protective equipment. Don't drive distracted. Wear your seatbelt. What's going to happen? Will you be more effective here? Absolutely. So be very careful with how we promote our safety plan. Okay. After a safety meeting, if we email the information to each employee and that they reply read, understood, and attended, is that good enough? Yes, it is. I mean, it will work. It's acknowledgement. But what we have to look at is effectiveness. What's your injuries like, Debbie? Are they still going up? Are they still flat? Or are your injuries going down? And then you got to really ask yourself, if it's a critical safety policy, do you really think folks are reading it? And that's kind of my rub with like learning management systems and things like that. Are people really watching it? So if it's critical, I really, really need you to think about it. If it's a critical safety issue, like drug-free workplaces, fall protection, driving, explaining the penalty, we need to get in front of our employees. I really think we need to take time to get in front of them. I know you may have a ton of employees, but that's sort of the cross that we have to bear to get them together to fully explain this. Because it's not about the documentation. It's not about the penalty. It's about effectiveness in reducing losses. Okay. So something to think about. We talked about this. How many injuries would have been prevented if just one rule were to be followed? Okay. So just think about that. Moving ahead with your safety rules. Now, my strategy is this. And if I came to your company as a safety director, this is what I would do. Oh, we may need this. And I get it. All your lockout, tag out, and all your hazard communication, all of our little compliance things. But the question I'm going to ask you is, how many times is OSHA going to actually look at this? Pretty rare right now. It's not happening right now. Program evaluations aren't really happening right now. So what I'm going to do is back off, and I'm going to say, I need to be effective in reducing losses. I need to get my safety rules into a easy to read, easy to understand format, one page. You do this, you're going to be okay. Now my compliance stuff goes in here. Our safety rules must start at the top by addressing top losses and top types of fine. No unwritten safety rules. Get them all on paper. Be very direct with how you write them. And I'm going to talk about that here in a second. Rules must be in plain language, easy to understand. And every rule you have in this book needs to be chatted, needs to be talked about with your employees. But what we're talking about here is this. So let's make it easier for you. And I can help you develop these. Now, if you're not prepared to enforce the rules, don't have them. Because we'll talk about that here in a minute. Document all training, meetings, and reviews with employees. That is a safety must have. We need to document more. I work with multiple employers that say, well, we talk about it all the time. We talk about it all the time. We talk about that all the time, but they produce no documentation. The 50% penalty, this is what we're talking about. Chapter 287 of the work comp policy or work comp law in Missouri says if the employee fails to use safety devices provided by the employer, or fails to obey safety rules, compensation could be reduced 25 to 50%. It's also a leverage point when the claim is being argued for increased benefits. We use it as a leverage point. The penalty, and did you know that? Did everybody on a call, did the folks on the call know that you could seek a penalty on work comp benefits when employees fail to follow a written safety rule. Or I'm sorry, a safety rule. It doesn't even say written here. What we're going to recommend is written and enforced. Okay. So know that you have strength and safety. When I tell you to follow these rules, I'm also telling you that if work comp gets a hold of this, you could have 50% of your benefits taken away. Also, but let's be fair with the employee. You've showed them the rules on a regular basis. They've signed for the rules on a regular basis, and you're enforcing it. Meaning, if you don't wear your hard hat, you get written up or sent home. If you don't wear your seatbelt, you get pulled out of the truck, you get sent home. Okay? Moving ahead, drug-free workplace. Reduces work comp benefits by up to 50% in instances of positive post-incident drug tests. So are we telling our employees this? Listen, if you're injured, you're going to receive a post-injury drug and alcohol screen. If it's positive, I'm not sure what MEM in the court's going to do with you. But there could be up to a 50% penalty. Also, in the event that the employee is drunk or it's proximate cause, the work comp benefits could be forfeited. So they could lose all their benefits if they're intoxicated or refuse to test. So chapter 287 of the work comp law, I can send you more info on this if you would like it. Just email me. But remember, we have strength and safety. But you have to document. You have to fairly review these things. Okay. And you have to get signatures on a regular basis and enforce it. We must show that employer actually enforces a formalized safety policy. Now remember, I say policy, it could be a rule or whatever. Supporting safety documentation includes the actual safety policy signed or acknowledged by the injured worker, possibly during a new hire orientation or during other ongoing safety meetings. Sign-in logs or attendee rosters for the actual safety policy training, followed by examples of disciplinary write-ups for violation of policy. Please document more. Okay, that's what we need to take a penalty. Also, we need to be specific in our safety plans. We don't need to have these vague statements like obey all traffic laws or obey all OSHA laws. How that doesn't work in court is an attorney's going to say, do you know all the traffic laws? Do you know all the OSHA laws? How does this guy know all the OSHA? Nobody does. Safety pros don't know all this stuff. We have to do some digging. Daily, we have to dig for this. So let's be specific. Seatbelts must be worn when conducting company business. Maintain two-person lift always of over 50 pounds. And you get this. I'll send this PowerPoint out, but be specific. And that's what you can do in your safety rules. Okay. Also, remember, when we get involved with safety rules, safety rule and drug-free workplace penalties, it saves policyholders a lot of money. Right now, for every violation that we've taken, we're averaging a $44,000 savings on the claim. We're also getting a positive test for marijuana. Number one's marijuana. We get a ton of citations on marijuana or safety. We get a ton of drug-free workplace penalties on marijuana. So the post-incident drug test is very important. Also, remember the post-incident drug test on emergency treatment is important. We see them fall through the cracks when people are in the ER. So we highly recommend you work with somebody like Tomo Drug Testing or Mid-Missouri Drug Testing to figure out a way to get into the ER or to get into the hospital to get that drug-free the post-incident drug screen taken within 24 hours. So we are seeing significant savings for you if you can provide the documentation and that you say, listen, we have these safety rules. We enforce them. We talk about them all the time. But Bob went over there and didn't wear his seatbelt. Now we've got a crash. Okay. Safety rules can come from PPE manuals. They can come from the tools themselves. Okay. If you're using hand tools, we want to wear eye protection, right? If we're using a ladder, we don't want to step on the top rung, right? So that's where I get a lot of safety rules is directly out of owner's manuals or off the warning labels of the equipment. And oftentimes the equipment tells us we have warning labels. This machine says use the seat belt when the rollover bar is up on this tractor. Well, that's a safety rule. I'm probably going to put that in my safety manual. If they don't wear their seatbelt and they're injured, I'm sorry. I don't know what to tell you. We need to make better decisions with regard to our own personal safety. So from the standpoint of a must-have, we need evidence. If I came into your operation, I would need you to show me evidence that you're preventing injuries. Not talking about it. Well, we talk about it all the time. I need evidence, and so does OSHA. Yak tracks, those are the slip-on ice cleats for slip-trip fall prevention. Three-point contact policy that's trained and enforced. Fall arrest system. If they work at heights and they're not wearing fall protection, it's an OSHA citation, but it's also something that we wouldn't allow. We would write official recommendations that would go to the underwriter, and we would have to have compliance or else your policy's in jeopardy. Evidence of overexertion prevention, post-offer employment testing, engineering controls, training, lifts, things of that nature. Evidence of vehicle crash prevention. Not only do we have the seatbelt policy, but we need to prevent the vehicle from crashing in the first place. Speed control. Okay, speed control, telematics. Evidence of struck or injured by prevention. That's lockout, tagout, machine guarding, that kind of thing, right? PPE, eye protection, head protection, proper gloves. So I need evidence of this. But remember that if you expect anything, if you give them PPE, and I've got my COVID mask here, you know, but if you give out PPE, like eye protection, it should be in a safety rule that's written. And the safety rule should be acknowledged and enforced. When was the last time your written safety rules were signed? Some things to think about. Read, reviewed, and signed. And my recommendation is, maybe I get fussy with online training and things of that nature, but if it's really big deal for your company, if it's a killer, if it's an OSHA Focus 4 issue, if it's a vehicle crash issue, if it's going to cause significant injury or illness or problems for your company, I really recommend getting face-to-face with employees. I know it's tough, but I've done it. I've had to do that, and I've done it. When was the last safety meeting your employees attended? The annual stuff I don't agree with. Is what it is. It's not enough. We need sometimes daily. If I'm a construction company where the job site changes every day, daily safety meetings. When was the last time the employee was held accountable? A lot of us have a safety plan, but it's worthless because nobody wants to enforce it. Does anybody perform inspections? Does anybody go out and look for problems? The thing about an inspection, we have to remember, an inspection finds problems before they find your employee. Okay? So if you just took a walk and grabbed a Coke or a cup of coffee and went out and took a walk, what would you see in your operation? Folks following safety rules? Equipment that's decent? Or is it stuff that needs a bunch of adjustment or lights out, that kind of thing? Or employees not wearing their gear, that kind of thing? Also remember that all this documentation, all your safety plan, all of your training, your documentation, your corrective action can work in an OSHA defense called an affirmative defense, employee misconduct defense. Just because you got a citation doesn't mean that you're responsible for it. There's no citation issued if you have employee misconduct, but you have to be able to prove that you've done the safety meetings, you've done the safety enforcement, you have piles of documentation, and the employee was acting out of our safety rules, he was acting out of the bounds, and you just happen, as the OSHA compliance officer, just happen to see him working alone, that kind of thing. But you have to demonstrate that you as the company have done all of that, okay? So that will also help you, not only with the OSHA or with the Missouri Work Comp penalties, but with OSHA. Safety meetings versus training. I do recommend we do more safety meetings, but also a lot of machinery does require specific training. And I can help you with that. So when we say training or we say meetings, I mean, don't lump it all together. When we get our employees together for meetings, that's fine. But those employees would need specific training on things like forklifts. Remember that forklift powered industrial trucks is a top citation for OSHA. If they see one of your employees riding on that truck, they're going to say, or operating that truck, they're going to say, show me where the operator has been trained. So when we do safety meetings, remember that whatever safety rule you expect, we have to have the rules written. When we do the training, we have to reference the rules. So we have the rule, the equipment, the job or process, we have the associated safety rules. We do the training and get documentation, and then we follow up. Are they actually, we did the safety meeting, but are they actually doing any of it? We're doing, you know, we go out and do an inspection. Are they wearing their hard hat? Are they wearing their seatbelt? And then we monitor and enforce, right? So you either followed the rules or you didn't, and you're going to get written up. Or let's say we're super cool and we give the employee a nice reward. Okay. So really quickly, I know I'm running long, but we're going to go ahead and move on here real quick. And I'm going to go ahead and start working to wrap up. But remember, inspections are a big deal. This particular piece of machinery this is a walkie pallet jack, had a broken plug, and the employees knew it was broken because they would be scooting across the warehouse and the pallet jack would just stop. It would stop and it would throw the employee off. Well, they all laughed about it until a worker got on there and it threw them off and they actually hit their head, and it was a very expensive claim. That plug was broken, as you can see in my left-hand photo. A $150 part would have saved a $213,000 injury and worker suffering. So remember that. We need to do inspections. That is a must-have for a safety program. Look for things like bald tires. That particular truck wrecked in a rainstorm, and all the tires were bald. Also, it does open you up for employer civil liability when you knowingly make employees work with unsafe equipment. Okay? So just think about that. Are they wearing seat belts like they should? Are they driving distracted? Go out and look. What are your employees doing? It's scary to see how many people drive distracted. And I'm going to work on wrapping up now, but asking for trouble, lack of timely reporting is when you don't tell us when an employee's injured. Always tell us. If anybody's bodily injured on the job, tell us. Just do a report. Just call us and say, listen, I just want to let you know. We file a report, no big deal. Lack of investigation. Is it even your work comp claim? No drug-free workplace program. No written safety rules. No directed medical care. No timely return to work, light duty. And no proof of any safety enforcement. These are bad news items. And you need to look at, what are you really doing? Okay. Another issue that we talk about too from safety. This is kind of out of the bounds of what we're talking about today. But please look, are you hiring uninsured subcontractors? If you are putting people on your work comp, the average claim on an uninsured subcontractor on your work comp is $410,000. You don't want to do that to yourself, to your own work comp policy. Make sure that whoever you hire, it has work comp insurance. Okay, this is it. Your challenge for 2021, zero injuries. Let's recap what we've talked about today. Your written safety rules, we can help you with those, but check them out. When were they updated last, and when was the last time they were actually shared with employees? Doing our safety meetings, let's do more than not. I don't believe in the annual. I don't think it's effective. We have to be effective. Get the injuries down. Safety meetings. Let's know what we're spending in terms of fines, okay? Fines and work comp costs. Let's share that with upper management. Do they even know? Okay, let's look at safety improvements, have a return on investment. Okay, let's enforce the rules. And you need to have the authority to do that. Okay, enforce the rules, document more, communicate with us. We have many programs out there. I'm going to back out of this really quickly, and I'm going to show you one couple of things real quick. And then we're going to go work on wrapping up. Anybody on the WebEx today have questions? Any questions? Unmute and type them in. We're going to work on wrapping up. I do want you to know that we have programs in place. I mentioned post-offer employment testing. That's to verify that the employee is physically healthy enough to do the work for your company. We have a post-offer employment testing program. We have training. I will help you with that. Drug and alcohol testing programs, telehealth, safety grants, and safety dividends. These are things that are available on mem-ins.com. So you want to check those out. Holy smokes, I owe you 5 minutes. Any questions? Was this helpful? Was this helpful? You notice I can't spell. Does anybody want to hop on? Debbie, thank you very much. Cheryl, thank you. Here's what I want to offer. Everybody on the call today, if you need some help or would like to do a webinar for your company or safety webinar, let me know. If you would like more consultation one-on-one through like a Zoom meeting, let me know. Call me. Send me an email. I'll set something up. If you would like more in-depth discussions about this, let me know. We're doing this session. We're doing incident management plans next month, and I will see you there. If nobody has any additional questions, I thank you. Thank you for your business. Thank you for your attention to safety. Let's keep it on the up and up for 2020 and 2021. And take care, everybody. Take care and thank you.